ممنوعیت‌های اخیر حکومت سرپرست بر کار و بانوان پای شمار زیادی از چهره‌های بین‌المللی را به افغانستان کشاند. صحبت‌های آنان با مقام‌های کانونی چه دستاورد را در پی داشت؟ آیا امید برای برداشتن این محدودیت‌ها بر کار بانوان در افغانستان وجود دارد؟ آقای یانیگلند، دبیر کل شورای پناهندگان نروژ، به کابل آمده و با مقام‌های کانونی روی این محدودیت‌ها رایزنی کرده. از او می‌پرسیم که چی نتیجه در پی داشتن این دیدارها و آیا امیدوار هست که مقام‌های کانونی این محدودیت‌ها را بردارند؟ سلام، وقتتان بخیر. من حامد بهرام میزبان شما و آقای ایگلند هستم. Mr. Ian England, Secretary General of the Norwegian Refugee Council. I'm honored having you here today with us.
My pleasure.
Thank you. You're visiting Afghanistan for the second time in 5 months to persuade the de facto authorities to reserve their bans on female staff working with NGOs. Has it yielded any fruits so far?
We had good meetings in Kandahar. Last time I was here, I only met ministers in Kabul. This time we concentrated on the Taliban leadership in Kandahar. And they told me two things. Number one, that the ban on female education and female work in humanitarian organizations is going to be lifted through the issuance of guidelines. And that these guidelines were nearly finished. So we're hoping to see the guidelines very soon so we can restart work with our female colleagues across Afghanistan, and girls can come back to secondary school, to other schools, to universities. The second thing they indicated was that we can negotiate an interim solution in Kandahar for our female colleagues so that they can reach women in great need here in Afghanistan, and we're hopeful that that can be reality very soon, because our female colleagues want to come back. They want to help their sisters in Afghanistan according to the Afghan values, tradition, Sharia law, etc., which we always have respected in NRC the last 20 years of our work here.
Right. So these two points were raised back in Kandahar.
Yes.
And who assured you of guidelines and the interim solutions?
Yes.
Which authorities, I mean?
This was the deputy governor of the province, who is an important person. He advises also the people around the supreme leader. I met the director of the economic department, who knows us well because he has been working with us for a very long time. Remember, we worked across Afghanistan over these last 20 years. We also worked in Taliban-controlled areas. We had schools in Taliban-controlled areas for boys and girls. So they know that we're here because we want to help the Afghan people. We were not part of a Western project. We did not leave when NATO countries left. We're here to stay to help Afghan population, but then the authorities have to help us help the Afghan people. If they make problems for us, we are paralyzed. I'm hopeful that our problems will now soon be over and that we can scale up work, because there's a great need to address here in Afghanistan now.
I will focus on humanitarian assistance here in Afghanistan, but before that I would like to clear the interim solution and guidelines which is given to you back there in Kandahar. What are they clear enough on interim solutions? What are the interim solutions? What were the definition? Were there any clarity on interim solution?
Yeah, of course, the general guidelines would mean that the ban would end with the new guidelines on dress code, on mahram, on separation of sexes in the workplace. All of these things that we want to respect, have respected. The interim solution is a locally negotiated way for us to restart work according to Afghan values and traditions, but without delay. Because let me give you an example. At the moment, there are 10% of households across Afghanistan have a single mother to lead the children. These are widows. These are women who have lost their husbands. A husband could have been be out of the country. How can we reach them with males only? We cannot. It's against Afghan traditional values. So I think Taliban government leaders.
And could you convince the Taliban with such points that the points that you have raised there with them? Were they convinced with what you were saying to them?
They do understand that they have actually created a tremendous dilemma. They want to help the widows. They prevent our female colleagues from working. They would say it's wrong for males to reach out to females outside of their own family. Mm-hmm. So how do we help these? That's why we will have and can have interim solutions. I'm sure there will also come something now for female education. Another dilemma here that the government has to realize. How can they say that only female health workers can attend to female health?
Right.
Attend to female patients and prevent education beyond primary school for girls. There will be no health workers in the future. Mm-hmm. There has to be education, and I'm hopefully this will come very soon.
In regards to the guideline, you said you said that soon it will be public or it will be drafted. Were there any clarity that did it give you any timeline when it will be? Because we have already heard a lot of you have been hearing that soon that's word a lot here in Afghanistan. Were there any timeline?
I asked
them
to define soon.
Yes.
Is it tomorrow? Next week, next month. what they told me was that the majority of the issues have now been resolved in the guidelines. So there is little remaining to be settled. So that's a good thing to hear. The last thing should then be able to settle in within days. Of course, then there needs to be an approval of these guidelines. I think we should have been a right also to be consulted on this, because it's our work. We come here as guests. We come here voluntary. We bring resources from other places. Norwegian taxpayers and individuals, private people give us funding. They don't have to do that. They do it because they are out of the good heart, because they want to help women, children, families in Afghanistan. Mm-hmm. So we should also have been consulted on this. How can we, the authorities of Afghanistan, help you so you can help our people? That should be the attitude, and I feel that is coming more now than before. In January, I was very disappointed when I came and told them, you slammed us with these two bans with no warning. There was never anyone who found any faults in the way we operate. We adhered to all of the rules and regulations, and still it became a nationwide ban.
Right. You had your answer, but I still want to reiterate myself and ask a question here. I want it to be even more clear. It seems that you're indefatigably trying to get women back to workforce along with your international partners. Do you think you'll overcome such a difficult struggle?
I think we can overcome it, yes. Listen, we are already working in the education sector. Humanitarian organizations are working in the health sector with women. That's two exemptions already there. There are also places where there have been other exemptions for emergency work, etc. So we have resumed work to some degree. But we're not at all where we should be. We should not be lower than we were in last December. At that point, we had reached 770,000 Afghans, we in NRC,
right,
during the last year. Mm-hmm. We had 1,500 Afghan humanitarian workers, roughly 1,000 men and 500 women working with us as our employees. Today, we are far below that. We've had to let go 220 colleagues, because the funding stopped since we were not able to implement, and since donors believe it is wrong to give funding if there is not at all any gender equality. So my message then to the donors is also there. Don't politicize humanitarian aid. Continue to fund our operations.
Did they?
I think they politicize it when they say, mm-hmm. when people say, I dislike the Taliban and what they're doing. They discriminate women. They ban women's work and education. So we have to withdraw money from Afghanistan. I think that's politicizing aid, because the aid is there for the poorest of the poor, for mm-hmm. the hungry, etc. They should engage with the Taliban leadership and tell them, like I do, that we disagree. Engagement is much better than withdrawal of aid to the poorest.
And following the restrictions and following the bans, some of the UN, including your organization, suspended their activities here in Afghanistan. If there are more bans on female stuff, if there is no hope, so you see women back to the workforce, will you cease completely your operation here in Afghanistan, or will you continue?
We will not leave Afghanistan, but
even if the women are not allowed to work here?
If women are not allowed, it means that we will have to stop working in many sectors mm-hmm. for a very long time. But I'm sure we will have the exemptions needed. I'm sure that this will happen. We are slowly but surely coming back to work. We need then the guidelines soon, and we need the local, regional, interim solutions immediately. Then we can restart work. At the moment, millions of children, hundreds of thousands even of lactating, breastfeeding women are so malnourished that it is a danger for their life. So the humanitarian crisis is very deep at the moment. Mm-hmm. And this happens at the same time as humanitarian organizations have to cut rations, cut the meager rations and give to fewer people because we lack the funding of the past.
And do you think that the international community as well has some sort of a role forcing the de facto authorities to reverse their ban?
I don't think they can force the authorities mm-hmm. to do anything.
Suggest.
I mean, they are not here. They are.
Give them some options.
But I think they can give now, through engagement, the positive option and say, listen.
Engagement. Do you think recognition?
Recognition, I don't know. I mean, I think they should reestablish the embassies.
Some of the countries did this.
It's in diplomacy, you don't recognize mm-hmm. regimes or governments. You recognize countries. My country, Norway, has recognized Afghanistan for a very long time. Mm-hmm. And regimes have come and gone. Governments have come and gone. But we recognize Afghanistan, and our ambassador should come back very soon. Mm-hmm. I'm lobbying for that. I'm lobbying for the European ambassadors to come back. I'm glad to see the European Union here already. They should come and engage with the Taliban authorities and also
tell. What's their viewpoint right now? Will they return back to Kabul? And will they establish their presence here in Afghanistan?
They're coming more and more frequently, mm-hmm. and I think some of them will establish a permanent presence, like the brave women leading the European Union delegation here. They're here, so why are not these mm-hmm. male ambassadors sitting in Islamabad and Dubai and in Doha coming to stay? That's what we're asking for.
And you tweeted today, and I want to quote it, that like there is an urgent need for political talks in and around Afghanistan to end the stalemate. What do you mean by that?
What is needed is political agreements. First,
agreement between which side?
On two levels. One, mm-hmm. within Afghanistan, it's very important that there is an inclusive government here. No country should be ruled by a single movement forever. We believe in general democracy. Number two, mm-hmm. there should be a political agreements between Afghanistan's leadership, de facto leaderships, and the rest of the world that can make sure that Afghanistan comes into the financial system. that the foreign assets that are frozen are released for the Afghan people. They belong to the Afghan people. Not to a government, but to the people. And they don't belong in Washington, D.C. They belong in Afghanistan for the people. There needs to be agreements on a diplomatic presence. There needs to be agreements on human rights and gender equality here and so on. There should be a political process so that Afghanistan again is part of the international community where it belongs. And the Afghan economy needs to flourish again. Mm-hmm. It's now struggling, as you know.
And you have pointed out to the inclusive government here in Afghanistan. What they claim is that they have already an inclusive government. And they criticize the international community for not defining what's inclusive government, as they already claim they have. What sort of inclusive government do you suggest?
As a humanitarian, I'm not going into that, but of course it needs that.
What do you suggest the international community for that?
All of the population, all of the minorities, all of the different religions, all of the different communities feel represented in government, of course. And there should be a possibility for them to do so. This may take time, but I'm just referring generally. I'm not a politician, I'm a humanitarian worker. Mm-hmm. I would like to see that the political conclusions...
But your humanitarian work and activities turn to be political right now. It's politicized, as you just before mentioned.
Others are politicizing it. We're not. Mm-hmm. We help
but
the people.
But now you have to deal with politics.
But what we can say to you is, I'm not going to, as a humanitarian worker, to solve the problems of Afghanistan. Mm-hmm. The politicians and the diplomats and the leaders have to do that. It's wrong to believe that a whole population can live out of humanitarian aid. We're supposed to help the most needy, the widows, if you like, the children who are orphaned, the people who are suffering from natural disasters, those who are returning from Pakistan or Iran, where they have been refugees. That should be our natural work, not feeding a whole nation. At the moment, 28 million people need help. Mm-hmm. 28 million people. That's two-thirds of the population.
And you have mentioned about the international community as well. So recently, United Nations convened a meeting in Doha. My question is, both sides are trying to engage. They emphasize on engagement. Why is that engagement not taking place? What hampers that engagement, do you think?
Well, I think there are issues on all sides. I think it's good that the United Nations try to assemble the international community for a constructive policy on Afghanistan. But listen, they need to come to Kabul. They need to talk to the government here. They need to go also to Kandahar, like I did, to speak to leadership there. They need to engage. I'm speaking now also from Kabul to big international media, Western media, the largest media, explaining the crisis in Afghanistan, urging humanitarian assistance, but I'm also urging engagement. As I am urging engagement from the de facto authorities here, with all parts of society in Afghanistan, to ensure that there will be a government based on full human rights for all communities.
And do you think now's the time the international community should review their decision on engagement with them, like recognition, unfreezing, as you just mentioned, the Afghan assets and offering them or granting them the permanent seat of Afghanistan back in the United Nations, delisting them from the blacklist as well?
Well, I'm not going into all of these issues. On the freezing of assets, yes, I've been very clear to say this belong to the Afghan people. There need to be talks on how this can flow to the Afghan people in a way that is transparent, unbureaucratic, uncorrupt, and in a way that benefit the people, including livelihoods and development. There needs to be engagement, really.
Right. And addition to one of your tweets, there is another one as well. And you said that Western diplomats are slow to return to Kabul to join your efforts. So I want to know, like, why the Westerns are slow joining your efforts here in Afghanistan. What held them back?
You have to talk to them. But I have said to many of them, come back. It's safe. I mean, we're here. I've been now my third visit here since the Taliban government took over nearly 2 years ago. I feel safer. It's not a problem of safety. It doesn't mean that you recognize whichever political movement here. You recognize the country, come back, engage. We need you here. That's my message to the international community. But I also maintain the Islamic countries have also a big responsibility to help us. They are here. So I've engaged with Pakistan, I've engaged with Iran, with Qatar, with Turkey, with many countries, with the Organization of Islamic Countries that we know well and we work well with. We work in 20 Islamic countries. We have no problems in any of them in reaching the people in need. We work according to national traditions there across the world. We're a large organization. We help 10 million people across the world. We would like to resume work not only to the levels where they were in December, to increase here. We want to do more development work, livelihoods work, but also work for gender equality.
And since you're here in Afghanistan, you can see closely what's happening here in the country. How do you see the humanitarian crisis here in the country, in Afghanistan?
The humanitarian crisis is deep and deepening. There are millions starving. There are millions in acute need of humanitarian aid. And at the same time, we, the humanitarian organization, are underfunded and we are hampered by not having our female staff there. So rations are being cut, offices are being closed. I explained it also to the Taliban leaderships and saying, more people need aid, and the aid is being reduced at the moment. Help us, help your people.
And do you think when you leave Afghanistan, you have achievements for what you're looking here? Will you have that? Will you gain that?
Well, what I have are now, I'm hopeful as I leave, that we will have agreements that will enable us to resume our work across the country. And then I will, helped by my able Afghan staff here, female and male, including our female colleagues, will also make statements to the world and say, come back, engage, help us, invest in the future for the Afghan people. We need to give hope to the Afghan boys and girls so that they want to stay and build Afghanistan and not feel that they have to leave and walk to Europe. That is not the future. The future is for Afghans is in Afghanistan. We need, however, to enable that is a good and fruitful and promising future.
If the fact authorities do not revise their decision on their bans, and the international community just insist on that, and there's a clash between both sides, how will be the future for the Afghans?
Well, that would be very bad. But I'm hopeful. I think we can solve this.
And what means it will be better?
Every month now we're doing more work again here because we have exemptions. We have possibilities to work. Now I think that will accelerate with the new agreements and signals we have. I'm meeting with the Ministry of Economy tomorrow here. We will discuss further possibilities for them to help us. I'm hopeful. We are staying here. I'm going to be fighting for the Afghan people forever. We hope to see now a brighter future for Afghanistan.
Thank you so much, Mr. Jan Egeland, Secretary General of the Norwegian Refugee Council. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Nice place.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Take care.